Thank you very much. So we're here today to talk about designing an ethics and privacy program in particular for AI and ML applications. And I'm really excited to be here with Alexandra and Ilana. I do this in legal practice, but they're the ones who are running this day-to-day at their companies, and we're gonna learn a lot from them and how they implement this on a day-to-day basis. So one of the first things we are, I'm a privacy professional is where I got my start, and I know Alexandra similar for you, and we're thrust into an ethics role because of data. And one of the first things we wanted to do here is to define what is data ethics. So Alexandra, to you, what is data ethics?
That's the $10,000 question or the $100,000 question. So I think as privacy professionals, if there's any privacy attorneys or privacy managers in the room, we've been looking at building out privacy and security programs for several years now. And even if we haven't been calling it ethics, we've been making ethical judgments and determinations in addition to the legal advice we've been giving our business colleagues and clients. But what we're thinking about in terms of data ethics is sort of this new thing that's coming out of how we treat big data sets. What are we looking at in terms of when we're dealing with AI and ML and algorithms beyond just personal data or what's required under GDPR? How do we think about what's the legal thing to do, what's within legal bounds, but then what's the right thing to do? What sits within your company culture and values? And we're also going to be talking about some new legislation coming out of the EU and other places globally that are actually going to be putting some legal requirements in place to document and do assessments around ethics. So if you can put up, you know, there's a couple of definitions floating around out there. So, you know, in companies, you'll typically have your ethics or compliance department, and those are typically looking at employee conduct, your code of business conduct, whether it's, you know, your export control, things of bribery, all the things that your compliance department is concerned about. That's one type of ethics program, and we're seeing that there's definitely collaboration between ethics, that sort of big umbrella ethics, and what we're seeing in data ethics. But what we're going to be talking about today is particular to building out your data ethics program, leveraging what you might already have in place with your privacy and security program, and oftentimes working with your litigation and compliance department as well.
If I could just add to that, from a practitioner perspective, I'm a data scientist by training. My job historically has been to take these massive data sets that I either collate as a company or use from our clients to build models. It's thinking about the extension of that and from a practitioner perspective, reframing not just what can I do with this data, but what should I be doing with this data, and therefore by extension, what types of systems should we be building? What do we believe should actually exist? And it's important to bring together all of those perspectives.
In that respect, it's a much broader question than what can I do with the data. Mm-hmm. It's what should I be doing? When you go to a lawyer and you say, what can I be doing with the data? I can point you to all the laws and I can say these are the rules and the baselines. But it's really something that you have to define for yourselves as a company. What are your values? And where will you draw the line in terms of benefits to society, to your user base, to your customers, and so forth? And in that respect, so what are some of the risks?
Yeah, so if you guys read the newspapers, you've seen all the horror stories about sort of AI, ML gone wrong, whether it's, you know, what happened in the UK with some of the school entry exams and algorithms that disproportionately gave seats away, and you know, the lower income population didn't get their choice of schools. You see it in policing, surveillance. There's something that was just in the New York Times recently about a company called Axon that makes tasers, and their ethics board had recommended not going forward with a pilot that they were considering that would have applied tasers to help take down school shooters. And the company disregarded the ethics board recommendation, and there was this big sort of public scandal where a lot of, I think 9 out of the 13 of the ethics board have now resigned And now the company has said, oh, we're not going to go forward with this plan for now. But it shows you that, you know, there's not just risks in terms of regulator inquiry or fines or litigation, customer complaints, but also just really negative PR if you're not thinking this through in terms of the customer impact and how this might be perceived. So if you want to be really cynical about it, the what should we do, you should be thinking about, do you want to be a New York Times headline? Do you want to be in the news in this sort of negative PR cycle? Or are you going to be doing the right thing with customer and employee data?
So with that sort of preface, I'm going to lean into some of the legal frameworks that are increasingly being adopted around the world that relate to the use of data for AI, ML, and then for encompassed in a concept that's most often written into laws currently as automated decision making. So many of you may be familiar with the EU GDPR, and there is an express rule that says data subjects have a right not to be subject to automated decision making. The default rule is that you cannot do so. You cannot make decisions that make major life decisions or impact major life decisions or have a disproportionate impact on people. Basically, these are conceived of as credit decisions, placement decisions, other things where an algorithm could decide without human intervention about how someone should be placed. The default rule is you can't do that unless you either get consent or it's allowed by law. And so there's a lot of discussion about what we do here in the States not being allowed in Europe unless you go and get consent. And I'm going to talk a little bit further about forthcoming legislation in Europe that's going to take this to another level. In addition to that, all automated processing, again, this is sort of general algorithmic rules, has to incorporate data protection by design principles. So you have to go through and consider the impacts of your automated decision-making systems. In many cases, it will require a data protection impact assessment, or DPIA. Now, you may undertake general privacy impact assessments as a company more broadly for new uses of data, but there's a specifically legislated, more detailed inquiry when you are engaging in automated processing that is significantly impacting people. Your notices to data subjects, the privacy notices that you get that became much more detailed starting in May of 2018 after GDPR was enacted, have to include a description generally of how the algorithms work if you are engaging in automated decision making. And so this was all relatively new when GDPR took effect again in 2018. And my clients have had to sit down and think very carefully through, okay, well, this is something we were doing as a matter of course, or we were justifying it based on general notice to individuals. Now, do we have to get consent to do so? What infrastructure do we have to put in place in the back end in order to evaluate the models that we're putting in place, particularly when we're impacting people? And it's not just Europe anymore. Brazil, South Africa, China have all pretty much copied the European model, although China has an even newer development. Ilana, we were talking about this the other day.
Yeah, China passed a law, it went into effect a few months ago, that specifically bans the use of recommender systems on online platforms, which is kind of a weird law in my personal opinion. A few reasons behind this. One is they believe that a lot of the content that circulates through online platforms is highly addictive, and they want to try and break that ban or break that cycle for their youth in particular. So gaming systems are particularly implicated under this type of a law. My personal feeling as well is that it's an attempt to learn a little bit more about Western technology companies and how they advance certain types of AI-based systems for recommendation. Recommender systems underpin a lot of what's currently conducted on online spaces. If you've streamed movies recently, you've been recommended some. If you've tried to buy anything online, you've been prioritized different goods and services. If you've searched anything, the search results are prioritized for you. All of those are recommender systems, and they're not all necessarily AI ML based. Some of them can be fairly naively sorted, but it is still an interesting advancement from a legal perspective.
So the takeaway is, if you're adopting anything in software or online services or cloud that's distributed globally, this is something you need to be aware of. You know, query how it's going to be enforced, because these are all pretty new. But when they're usually enforced when there's a big multinational company that comes to the attention of the local regulators. So that's something to keep in mind. I'm not going to read everything on this slide, but there are automated decision-making laws coming to the United States now. I put up California's, Colorado's, and Virginia's law. I prepared this slide before Utah and Connecticut enacted their laws as well. But we've borrowed concepts from GDPR in the U.S. Largely have kicked the implications of this to the regulators, who are then going to pass regulations that, starting in the second half of this year in California. So some of you may be familiar with the California Consumer Privacy Act, the CCPA. The California Privacy Rights Act was, thanks to the voters of California, has amended the CCPA and will take effect in January 1st. And this is one of the new developments that was added by the CPRA. And you can see they're going to add regulations related to automated decision making. And you'll have to include meaningful information about your algorithms if you're seeking to analyze or predict or profile someone based on their performance at work, economic situation, health, personal preferences, interests, reliability, behavior, location, or movements, basically anything that you're trying to do. So something to keep in mind. And also, we're in the middle of the rulemaking process, so if you have policy teams that are interested in engaging, now is the time to do it.
And Alexandra, Bret, correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't the federal government also produce a proposal that...
Oh, it just came out.
Yes.
A federal proposal just came out, notably lacking a Democratic senator sponsor, but it's our most meaningful progress towards a federal privacy legislation. And the key question is, will it preempt all the state laws or not? Mm-hmm. So do we have to keep looking at multiple state laws, or can we look at one single federal law? And that is very much to be determined. There's also, in terms of algorithmic and automated decision-making laws, there's existing rules in play. The Federal Trade Commission put out guidance on this last year, and they noted that if you are using algorithms that impact people in an unfair way, they've implying biased decisions or decisions that result in someone not being selected in a way, they can use their unfairness authority, which is, you think of the FTC's unfairness authority as regulating fraud. It's something which causes harm to someone, a consumer that's not reasonably avoidable and doesn't have countervailing benefits to competition. They've implied that if an AI system avoids or chooses someone or doesn't choose a certain population in a biased way, that could be a use of their unfairness authority. They've also cautioned that they may use their deception authority, which is historically how they've enforced privacy laws, which is, you said something will happen, you said you will use data in a certain way, or you won't use data in a certain way, and then you do. So they've cautioned to don't overstate the impacts of your automated decision making or AI ML systems. I know there's the marketing teams want to go out and want to make grandiose claims about what you can and cannot do. Rein that back a bit, because I think they're looking for a juicy case here. One other really interesting impact from the recent FTC actions here is that when companies have been processing information in a way that they've deemed to be violating the law, they have in recent cases, in recent recent settlements have required companies to disgorge the results of their algorithms. They've done this in a couple facial recognition cases where they've deemed companies to collect facial recognition information in a way that violated consumer expectations. They required them to delete their facial recognition systems. So that's something that can have more or greater business impacts. There's plenty of others. I'm not going to go into it, but one thing I wanted to flag at the bottom of this is there's a lot of hate about algorithms now. There's a lot of fear, uncertainty, and doubt and distrust. And so you have laws and bills being put forward, like the Algorithmic Justice and Online Platform Transparency Act, mm-hmm. Protecting Americans from Dangerous Algorithms Act. And this is, I think, part of techlash. And so it's just, again, something, and most of these laws are related to bias-related concerns in algorithms, but it's just something to keep in mind from a public policy perspective.
Yeah, bias, surveillance, manipulation, all of those words. I would also add that from my observation, I don't know if you guys feel differently, regulators don't often have a great appreciation for what AIML actually is. And so some of the danger of not being involved in some of the policy making is that we'll have something enacted that does not reflect anything we can actually implement.
Yeah, it's over-indexing because of some of those bad actors, like the risks and the bad things that have happened where it's sort of algorithms gone wrong. And I think it's the misunderstanding of the value of algorithms if done properly. So, you know, further in this presentation, we're going to talk about responsible AI and ethics by design and all the things that we can be doing within our companies and as we're sort of advocating for continued use of algorithms in the right context, right? We don't want to get rid of algorithms altogether necessarily. We just need to figure out a way to do it within the bounds of the law and within ethical principles that our companies might be putting forward.
So I think this is a really good example of the fear around algorithms. This was an investigation of Goldman Sachs by the New York Department of Financial Services for fair credit compliance, right? Issuing credit fairly. When the Apple Card came out, someone applied and their spouse applied, and he tweeted, he's like, "Hey, how come my credit limit is 20 times higher than my spouse's? When we live in the same place, we have the same income, we have shared bank accounts." Then Steve Wozniak retweeted, and he said, "Well, I did the same thing, and my wife's was 10 times, you know, my limit was 10 times my wife's. I think Apple should bear some responsibility here also." And this got to the level where the New York Department of Financial Services undertook a pretty lengthy investigation of Goldman Sachs, who was underwriting it, and they went through it and they determined everything was fine. The underlying issue ultimately was that credit is not allocated based on your shared bank account or your combined income. It's really based on if you're a secondary person on a card, you don't accumulate the same credit as the person who is the primary card holder. Based on the sort of public fear about this, about being discriminated against, this cost quite an investigation and presumably a large amount of fees, and they have published a report and public resources. So again, something that can come out of some of the uncertainty here. I mentioned pending EU regulation. From all my colleagues in Europe, they think it's pretty sure it's going to pass an AI regulation. Regulation is like GDPR. It applies equally all across Europe, like federal legislation in the US, and it's going to require a substantial amount of compliance infrastructure to be put in place when you are adopting AI systems that impact people. And you're going to have to, and it's gonna, it may change. It's still in the legislative proposal stage, and just a few weeks ago, I think, there were amendments issued by all the political parties in the European legislature, and there's something like 1,000 amendments, so things are going to change. But basically, it requires you to conduct a risk assessment of your AI application about how it's going to impact people. There's different categorizations in the middle column, we're going to completely prohibit certain types of practices, having a scoring system that is decentralized. And so then there are some that will be more acceptable, but we'll have transparency rules. But in any event, there's going to have to be risk analyses done. There's going to have to be some infrastructure put in place, and that's where compliance programs come in. We could talk just about the laws for the whole time, so I'm trying to go through these quicker. The European Digital Services Act is also coming out. What's on the slide focuses on just a portion of it, and the DSA is a much broader piece of legislation that's trying to bring offline marketplace rules into the online context. But ultimately, the big rules for algorithms and AI and ML is it's going to require all online platforms that are providing digital services, but particularly with respect to large online platforms, rules related to content moderation, recommender systems, and online advertising. There's going to be requirements to disclose your, provide more detailed disclosures about your algorithms. There's going to be rules that are related to allowing audits of the algorithms by European regulators. So again, if your online platform that engages in content moderation or allows for third-party content, there's going to be additional rules in play in Europe. So some of the common threads around these laws, there's going to be an increased focus on algorithms globally. If there's one thing you take from this presentation, from the legal perspective, that's it. The application may vary of the laws depending on the harm or perceived harm or impact on individuals. There are rules applying to decisions that produce legal or similarly significant effects on individuals, which is really a squishy standard, right? And I hope you talk about that later in the presentation. How do you determine when something is going to impact people and how it's going to impact people if you're just testing a machine learning use case, right? When you're just trying to see what connections you can derive from the technology. There's going to be requirements for privacy impact assessments. And other impact assessments, some countries will be opt-in, some will be opt-out for certain use cases. There's going to be a focus on discriminatory or disparate impacts, and then there's definitely going to be a requirement to provide more transparency around what you're doing. So you're going to get some practice in describing your algorithms. So with that, I want to move on to the real core of this presentation, which is how do you design your ethics program? And so, how should you help in a compliance role your companies be more ethical? And how can you use the tools at your disposal to do that, Alexandra?
Yeah, so it's a good question. I think what we're trying to do with this presentation is not scare everyone in this room about, oh my gosh, all these legislation that's coming, but highlight a couple of key risks that if your company is doing anything with AI and ML, and I believe you are, it's to do some inventory taking and look at the programs you already have in place that are touching on other data protection topics, whether it's your privacy program or your security program, because a lot of the things that Bret was talking about that are required now under GDPR and are going to be required in US states and under the EU AI Act have to do with having a program in place. So doing assessments, if you've already got privacy impact assessments, you can potentially add a couple of questions to make sure you're covering what's going on with your ML use cases. If you already have a governance structure and you have committees that are talking about use cases, make sure you're including the right data scientists and technical people who can talk about the impacts of the ML use cases. If you've got an escalation path to your executives and you've got a decision-making structure, you can incorporate some of this tracking against those high-risk AI categories in the EU AI Act. And I would caution, you know, be careful, because as I've been socializing this within my company, some of the feedback I get is, oh, well, you know, we're not doing the prohibited or high-risk AI use cases, so we don't have to build a program. And that's not true, because you need to be doing the assessments and have some sort of program so that you can document your low and medium risk use cases, because you're going to potentially need to justify how you made a decision that something is or is not high risk. So you can't just say it's high risk without actually going through the thought process and have some kind of documentation. So I think it's incumbent upon all of us to take a hard look at what's happening within our company. And there's probably some great projects that are happening that are relying on ML and that have some value, either to recommend things to your customers, to improve your products and services. So there's a lot of beneficial uses of AI and ML, but we need to be thinking about it from this compliance standpoint, but also this ethical standpoint. So that can be part and parcel of drafting your policies, looking at guidelines, looking at structures that are going to help you get your arms around what's going on with ML at your company, so that you're not going to trip yourself up. And also, it's not an impossible task, because I think those companies that do have privacy programs in particular in place, there's a lot of synergies with privacy programs and what we believe should be put in place for these ML use cases. One other thing that we put up here is this sort of service provider role. So we're seeing a lot of companies publish their ethical principles and publish their policies. And if they're service providers, they're saying, here's how we can help you, our customer base, also be ethical. So you can think about that in terms of a value add. You know, are you offering responsible AI as a service? You know, you're doing responsible AI within your own company, but it might be a product or service offering that you can offer to your customer base where some of these controls are already built into the products.
And I think to add to that too, a lot of times we're building capabilities or we're building technology and other people are procuring it and then using it, and you lose oversight over how people are using that technology. And if you believe that your technology needs to be used in a responsible way, then we need to educate consumers such that they understand the limitations and they understand the appropriate use cases.
So congratulations. You now have buy-in from management for implementing your data ethics program. So who are your primary stakeholders in this effort? And basically, where do you start?
Yeah. So. Governance harmonization is something, I didn't coin that term, but it's something we've been talking about at Autodesk, where I work, because we wanted to make sure that as we were putting in place our data ethics program and responsible AI, that we weren't creating a lot of administrative overhead. And so part of it is looking at some of the things that we already have in place. So part of it was, you know, talking to our security program leads, talking to the privacy program leads, talking to those in legal that already had put together some of these data protection programs, and thinking about, okay, how can we harmonize and how can we align all of these processes? So if you're a business team that wants to launch something related to ML or wants to engage an ML vendor, we don't have them scrambling to 10 different places and filling out 10 different forms. We have one consolidated intake process, and then behind the scenes, we can figure out where it needs to go and who needs to review, you know, the security aspect or the procurement aspect or the contractual aspect. So part of it is trying to make it easy on your business teams to do the right thing. And not make them jump through too many hoops from a compliance perspective. I'm trying to see if there's anything else in here. I think I've talked about most of these things here. Think about, you know, sort of the people, technology, tools, right? It's that same sort of thing. What's your framework for analyzing risks? What's the process? What's the program? What's the flow of sort of assessments? And how do you make that as easy on your business teams as possible, but also have a record so that you can go back and monitor that mitigations were put in place? How can you put controls in so that you can go back and audit? How do you make sure that if you get some sort of regulator inquiry or customer inquiry, you can go back and say, oh, well, this is how we justified this particular decision? And then what kind of platform can you build? Thinking about some kind of sandbox where you can have all of your technical controls built in to a data lake or some sort of platform where these ML use cases can be accomplished. Or you have your standard data sets where you can tell teams, oh, don't bother going through the headache of creating some data set. We have something already prepackaged for you that is fit for purpose, and we've already put the compliance wrapper on it. And here you go. Here's the path of least resistance. You don't need to go use that sensitive data set because this data set that we've sanitized for you and made compliant is going to serve your business needs.
And you do this with all of the extra budget that you're getting for this, right?
That's right. Well, I think part of it is, you know, it's convincing your executives that there is legislation and regulation coming. So this is not a nice to have, this is a legal requirement. So however you got the budget for GDPR, you need to start ringing those bells again and saying, you know, AI legislation is coming. But on the other hand, it's the right thing to do. And I think we're seeing a lot of companies that are forward looking and are being more public in saying, we take responsible AI seriously. Here's our policy statement. Here's the blog from our chief privacy officer. We've hired a responsible AI lead. We've hired a chief trust officer. You know, there is value in the marketplace of standing up and doing the right thing, and your customers are going to notice that, and you know, hopefully that will attract some sort of business.
And so what are some of the benchmarks along the way?
Yes, so as you're starting to put together, you know, if you're just starting today, and we know that a year from now we're potentially going to have this AI legislation coming out of Europe, what kind of framework can you put together? So what I mean by framework is, do you have a policy? Do you have guidelines? Do you have standards? Do you have a way to identify the use cases that you need to review? Like, how do you capture what's happening at your company to make sure that the lawyers, the data scientists, whoever you have as part of governance is actually looking at the right things so that you're not missing potentially high risk issues, but also you're enabling some of these ML use cases? Because kind of the flip side of having the high risk use cases that you're not addressing is this sort of paralysis within your company where well-meaning business teams will say, oh, well, legal wouldn't allow this, so I'm just not gonna do it. When in fact, if you had provided a path and some sort of framework and way for them to get a review, we would say to them, yes, that's fine, that's low risk, you know, maybe put some mitigations in place, go talk to the security team, but you know, go and do what you want to do. So you want to be thinking about how can you enable the teams to do the right thing and not go off and do something crazy. And then, you know, once you've sort of gone past that crawling phase and you have a data ethics framework in place, then think about you know, ethics by design. And we've got some good slides coming up where we're going to talk about what privacy by design means. Ethics by design is similar in terms of thinking of, from the very beginning, how can you bake ethics into your program? And so that could be part of your culture. It could be part of the onboarding to your new employees. It could be some of the things that your CEO talks about, that responsible AI, data ethics is important to the company and directing people to do the right thing. And then finally, you've got a whole governance structure in place. Maybe you have some sort of internal or external ethics board. You've got your escalation, you're reporting out to CEO staff. Maybe you're even reporting out to your board of directors saying, we put something in place, here are our goals, here's how we're meeting those goals, here are all of our accomplishments. And you're looking at things not just at the beginning of an ML project, but you're looking at them along the way. Just like we talk about within privacy, it's that data life cycle. So it's not one and done, but you have to keep looking at these models once they're out in production to make sure that you're monitoring and you're capturing what might be happening over time to continue that review to make sure that you're not introducing bias once it's in production, for example.
So let's get into some of the practical implementations, Ilana, if you want to start to talk about that.
Sure. So Alexandra mentioned there's a whole data lifecycle. There's also a model development lifecycle. Increasingly, companies are starting to standardize on the processes that they their development practices, their testing practices, even their data procurement practices for ML systems. And I put this slide up on the page, which is kind of a first line perspective on the different steps that we go through to building and implementing a model and ultimately monitoring it. And I say we do this, but it's more of we should do this. We don't often do this in completion. And these should align with the privacy by design, security by design, ethics by design types of steps. I can walk through this pretty quickly, but we have to start with understanding what we're actually trying to solve for, what the business problem actually is, what good will look like for this particular solution. This is where we really need to start thinking about the legal and ethical implications of what we're building. Who is this going to impact? How will it impact them? Is there a sensitive use application here that we need to be monitoring? We need to think in this case, is this something that could be high risk based on what the EU is saying or based on what our company is saying if we're implementing our own different practices? From here, as a team, as a development team, we typically have a hypothesis for what we're going to build. We have to build it before we know if it'll work. And from there, we go into this iterative process of getting data, processing that data, understanding what data we have, ultimately building and training a model. And I say that that's iterative because model development is very different from traditional software. You have to use a lot of information to train one model, not necessarily add additional features to an existing product, which means that if you want to make one change, you have to fix the whole thing. It's not just adding an additional attribute. And so this is incredibly iterative, and we have to evaluate throughout that process whether or not what we're building serves the purpose for which we expect it to. Does it perform as well as we want it to? Does it actually provide the safeguards that we need it to? Is it performing consistently for the populations we need it to? Do we do any type of bias testing? Anything in that space needs to be considered here. Only there, once we're comfortable with the model, do we make steps to deploy it, which has a whole process around software deployment and user testing that needs to be included here. Again, lots of parallels with privacy by design, security by design, and ethics by design. Do people who are expected to use the system actually understand how it works? Are they confident relying on its decisions? Do they feel like it adds value to the system that they're operating on? Do they even know it exists? This is actually a big problem. People don't always know that they're interacting with the machine learning system or that their data that they provided is going to be used to feed a model. Then we ultimately go to monitoring. How does this thing work in practice? Is it working sustainably? Is our performance decaying over time? Do we actually have a monitoring process on top of this? A lot of cases, no. People build a model and then they walk away from it to another super cool project, and there's not a great system in place to see if it's still serving our interests properly. And that's where we need to have additional practices as well. And it's completely fair at the end of all of this to say that you built something that 6 months out from now no longer works, but we need a process to evaluate that. And that's where that last stage gate comes in. I have these little numbers or black circles above there that are our stage gates. These are formal checkpoints that should connect to an overall governance process outside of the first line perspective.
You want to have a loop for 8 and 9.
Yeah.
Just continuous loop, keep monitoring.
Lots of loops throughout all of these.
Yes.
For sure. So you can just kind of flip through this. I wanted to kind of simplify this a little bit. Just that's that same 9-step process. You can see I do have my loop in there. For our purposes here, and to think about where some of the important questions are from a privacy and security perspective are that we need to be considering. I talked about the privacy and confidentiality of the training, the legality of using that information. When we're building and training models, there are privacy-preserving technologies people are increasingly at least exploring, if not relying upon, to try and make better use of potentially sensitive data while still having highly performant systems. These have their own challenges. If I don't think we'll have time to get through any of that, but I can certainly talk about that if you guys are interested there. When we actually get to the AI system, we still have privacy concerns, but there are a lot more security concerns that start to come in play here. People are very creative. They like to try and circumvent automated systems, fool them, manipulate them for various purposes. And so we know that that's happening and we need to protect against that. There's also a growing trend of model theft or model inversion or subversion, where people poison models with fake data, or they try and paying it lots of times to get access to the outputs, and then they can train their own model on top of it. So other types of security and privacy concerns that are starting to not be legislated or regulated yet, but concerning teams that are tasked with overseeing these.
I will say, to the extent that you can do some data manipulation, pseudonymization, other privacy enhancing, differential privacy, other privacy enhancing techniques on data, it does help from a legal perspective as well, because you're lessening the potential impact on identified individuals. Mm-hmm. So all the times where you need to invest in, you convince your teams to invest in those technologies, now's the time to ask for that.
And I'm actually wondering, given time, maybe we just pause with the slides and
sure.
Take any of your questions?
We have about 7 or 8 minutes left. Please.
So a couple of questions in terms of how you think about this. So the two things always concern me is, one, like, we obviously always need to like evaluate the model for bias, and it's very easy to say and very hard to do. How do you test for bias? What's the standard, right? Like, we don't even have a common standard among courts for employment bias and how they assess it. And so understanding that and looking at that in terms of how models work, I think, is really, really hard. And so, it seems there's a sort of hand-waving on sort of that core point. And then the other thing that is challenging about this, I'd love your thoughts on, is that if you control the data and you control the AI model, then this works great. But frequently people build, models that operate on customers' data, particularly if you're doing it as a service provider. So how do you do that when you take the model and you release it in the wild, but you have no control over the data set on which it operates?
Sure. I'm two very important questions, probably worthy of at least 50 minutes on either of them. So bear with us here while we try and get through that. Your first question around bias is a really important one. This is one of those things where I mean that regulators don't always understand what models do when they stipulate that they have these requirements. And so you'll increasingly see these types of things. Your models need to be fair. The challenge with that is that you're right, there are very few standards, if any, that we can rely upon. Certainly the only ones that really exist are in the employment context and in financial services for lending. Those have their own challenges from a compliance standpoint too. When you're building a model, the first thing you have to do, or not the first thing, but the first thing from a bias perspective that we have to do, is to think about what we mean when we say bias for that system. What are the protected groups that we're looking at that we need to consider? Is there intersectionality that we need to consider? What does fairness mean with respect to the comparison of that? The last time I looked, academic literature proposed over 35 different mathematical measures for bias just on binary classification problems, meaning yes, no, admitted, denied kind of situations. And that doesn't take into account all the permutations when you think of protected classes and how you compare that. And when I say intersectionality, I mean by race, by gender, by sexual orientation, and or the combination of those. And that's important because we view ourselves from an intersectional lens, just because the law doesn't. So when we're building models, and especially high-risk models, we need to collectively, not just the data scientists, come up with a definition that makes sense for us, document that, and then continue to test against that. And if we don't, then we don't have a justifiable way of going back and tracing it. And I think it's completely fine for people to disagree with your measure, but you have to know what you're trying to measure, and continuing to wade in murky water is not going to do us a lot of good.
And this is like balancing tests in the law. Mm-hmm. I call it the law of second guessing, right? A big headline hits and someone says, oh, protected class has been discriminated against in lending. There's a big investigation, and what it's going to come down to is whether you can produce that documentation, that compliance program that you've put in place to say, I've taken all the reasonable steps I can to account for this, and I've done something reasonable in light of the circumstances, and it's going to come down to proving a negative in some
yeah.
cases.
And I think also making sure that you have some sort of diversity in the group of people on your governance committee that's looking for bias, right? So if you have an internal committee, whether it's lawyers or your data science or your privacy program, whoever, however you're staffing this, think about how you have diverse points of view and how you're trying to solve that question of, you know, is there bias in our system, and then documenting it. And I think, unfortunately, we're going to sort of learn as we go, because we're going to see some case law of things that do have bias, even though the company tried their best to eliminate the bias.
Yes, please.
You answered one of my questions, which was about reproducibility and regulation. I work in a bank, so everything has to be, why did you do this? Well, here's why. There was a talk yesterday about AI bias detection, and they had two categories, which I wanted to ask about, and you sort of touched on with the previous question. They talked about transparency and fairness. Are those, is that a good dichotomy? Is there more that we should look at when we're looking at rooting out bias in these things? And do they map well into the regulation that you're talking about?
You can talk. You guys can talk about mapping to regulation. Transparency and bias are interesting complementary topics. Transparency, because if you need to understand how a model is actually operating, what information it's using in order to serve a particular decision, and if you know that and it's making decisions on something that perhaps is surprising or that you weren't expecting, that's a potential source of bias that maybe you haven't explored. So they are complementary. I wouldn't say those are the only two categories. There are trade-offs between bias, privacy, transparency, robustness all over the place. And what I mean by that is that So you need protected information to know if you're being biased. So that's like a very clear balance that we need to make. And in the privacy world, we're saying don't keep that information because that's a clear potential violation. In the bias space, we're saying we need that information because I can't tell you my system is unfair without knowing that. So that's a trade-off that we need to be considering. Again, something that regulators Absolutely. Are having a hard time grasping to, in my opinion. From a bias and a performance or a robustness perspective, you might be prioritizing a system that performs equally well for two populations, but perhaps historically there has been some reason or justification, or even if it's a systemic discrimination that has caused divergent activity between two different populations. So you have to make a decision about whether or not you need a fair system or one that is accurate. And that's also not something that we're super comfortable making, because it maybe reflects something that we don't want within our organizations, or it highlights systemic issues that we can't balance. So there are a lot of factors to consider.
That's my favorite. We want you to eliminate bias, but you can't collect the information needed to eliminate bias.
And in the lending
space. Yeah, go ahead. I think we have two more questions maybe we'll try and get in before the end. Yeah, go ahead, and then we'll grab you.
Yeah, so I actually have sort of two questions. You can cut me after the first if you want. First, thinking about this in comparison to GDPR, I can't help but be sort of a bit worried that, you know, the fundamental operations of GDPR, deleting data, giving it to users, those are not academic questions. But bias in machine learning systems is still an academic question, and something that I think we really don't have a handle on. I don't know, what are your predictions? Are we going to, from the court system, get new definitions of bias that, you know, are sort of worked out after the law is passed?
Yeah, I mean, we have a bunch of wishy-washy balancing tests in the law, and the regulators have to figure out what they mean by it, and they put out guidance, and their guidance talks about the lowest hanging fruit use cases, and they don't get into these shades of gray. So I think ultimately you have to go to best practice standards. You have to go to the literature and be able to defend your business practice by saying, I did what helps eliminate bias to the best of my ability from an academic standpoint.
Mm-hmm. And I would challenge that these are purely academic questions or even implemented only in academic environments. Companies are actively grappling with this today, and they're trying to implement literally whatever they can. And also importantly, there are a lot of vendors selling solutions that purport to solve these problems, and people are buying them. So,
no, totally. I didn't mean to suggest that it's only an academic question.
No, but I mean that like we need to know that this is a murky space before we buy expensive solutions that
And so then the second question here is, I'm actually very intrigued by this Chinese restriction on recommender systems, and I'm curious what the sort of distinguishing principle would be that allows one to separate perhaps Netflix recommendations, which seems like that's the target, from web search, which I imagine cannot possibly be the target.
I'm not an expert in the Chinese policy, so I don't know if I can. And
there's like a question about distinguishing principles in a matter of Chinese law enforcement. It's very much as the government seeks to enforce it.
Yeah.
And that may be very, very well what's going on here. I know we're at time. Can we take one last question and then that'll be it? This has been the criticism of overregulation in this space, a criticism of GDPR also. And the question is, what do you do as a company without a lot of resources? And you're saying, well, I have to put in place a whole compliance program and.
So for those who didn't hear the question, it's the cost of compliance and how are companies, potentially small companies that don't have, large resources to put a whole compliance program in place for AI, how are we going to approach this? It's a really good question. I don't have the answer, although I think you try to do what you can. You try to put in place some best practices with the resources that you have. And I think there will be some tools that are offered that are, even though it is murky and maybe we need to, look at them very carefully to make sure they're offering what their marketing pitch is saying they offer, but I think there are going to be some tools and some standardization over time to make compliance a bit easier.
I also think that the recommendations to date are quite coarse, at least on the AI side, the privacy side maybe a little bit less so. And so you could probably find a space in there that works for you, at least for right now.
Thank you, everybody, for coming.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.